Others will catch up, so we should get started already. So, good morning once more, and welcome to the Alternate School Disruptive Innovation Tech Program. This is the three of the program already. So, today I'll be exploring with you on how the World Wide and the how the World Wide Web and the Internet works. Okay, so most of us take the internet for granted. Okay, so I'm forgetting that it took centuries of successful advancement to reach the point where we can now instantly, easily, and inexpensively communicate with people all over the world. So even fewer stop to consider what it really is, where it came from, and what makes it tick. So, when we are deciding on whether to bring you this lecture, I in fact hesitated at first. I was certain that most people know what the internet and the World Wide Web really are. So, I set out to seek the wisdom of the crowd and ask my friends and colleagues, do you know what the difference between the internet and the World Wide Web is? And I was surprised to learn that most had no idea, and that convinced me that this lecture is needed. So, in the next couple of minutes, you will explore the internet and the World Wide Web origins, history, inner workings, how they changed the world, the potential and risks that they pose for your future and the future generations. We are going to piece together the origins and inner workings of the internet and the World Wide Web. And when we are done, you'll be able to amaze your friends and astound your family with the a newly acquired knowledge, or you can just keep it smugly to yourself. Either way, it will be educational, interesting, and a lot of fun. So, before we go forward, many might want to take notes. A handy tip would be activating your caption on the live here on the Google Meet. Activate the caption, and you'll be able to follow up, and take notes in whatever manner you can. Okay, so over the years, we have developed a variety of communication methods and technologies, and often the motives for these systems were rooted in conflict and war. So digital communications as we use today emerged in the mid 19th century with the electrical telegraph. Telegraphs used electrical currents and switches to send messages. The position of the switch on or off created electrical pulses, and these pulses or a bit of information traveled over electrical wires that were strung between two locations. To maximize its utility, the telegraph required a network of interconnected stations. It played a decisive role in the American Civil War and both World Wars, and its legacy still lives on. So modern computers today still rely on the same concept of bits of information to communicate. Near the turn of the 20th century, Alexander Graham Bell registered a patent that would forever depose the telegraph from its position as the modern marvel, and the telephone will become king of communication. The telephone industry quickly borrowed the telegraph's network structure to build a system of trunks and exchanges. The nearly or early 20th century gave birth to another invention that will fundamentally change our lives: the digital computer. So the first digital computers were electromechanical devices that use relays to open and close circuit. And these mechanical switches were soon replaced by the quieter, much more reliable vacuum tubes. Okay, so however, the excessive power demand and the heat produced by vacuum tubes limited the development and widespread use of computers. Early computer systems were functionally modeled on the human body. So just as our brain controls our eyes, hands, and toes through nerves, a mainframe serves as the central processing unit that directs activity through remote peripherals like keyboards, monitors, and printers. So mainframes lay the groundwork for modern computer networks, but the mainframe model itself was inherently limited as all communications had to pass through the central processing unit. So that was about to change fast. So transistors became commercially available in the around the 1950s, I believe. So small, efficient, and far more reliable, they quickly took over the place of vacuum tubes. And then Jack Kibble built the first circuit out of semiconductor material. And the integrated circuit was born. One of these tiny integrated circuits could replace millions of individual transistors and was far more reliable and efficient. And it was these ICs that opened the floodgates of computer technology development, the one that would fundamentally change our lives. So the Cold War between the US and the Soviet Union, brief history here, prompted huge capital investment in communication technologies. So rapid technological advances quickly followed. The North American Air Defense was established, NORAD for short. So NORAD is a joint US-Canadian defense agreement whose primary responsibility is to maintain a communication network to provide early warnings for strategic air command in case of an enemy attack. So while NORAD, NORAD's job is to monitor and provide warning of an impending attack, the semi-automated ground environment was created to direct the response to the attack. So SAGE, for short, was the first true wide area, real time, and fully connected digital system. So SAGE coordinated data transfer from dozens of remote radar sites in 20 sectors all over North America. That's a brief history here. You can, of course, Google is always a friend. You can always look that up. So these were collated into a unified image of the entire North American airspace. So such a feat, as you will believe, was considered to be science fiction just a few decades earlier. So while the military was deploying SAGE for NORAD, other technological advances like air travel were encountering problems that needed improved communication solutions. So in around 1950 or 53, American Airlines was struggling to manage the exponential growth of air travel reservations. And we are using the same manual system that had been in public and in place all the way since the 1920s. And then destiny intervened. One evening, Blair Smith, I believe, that's his name, I believe, a senior IBM salesman boarded a long a flight from Los Angeles to New York. So by chance, he was seated next to C.R. Smith, the president of American Airlines then. The two Smiths introduced themselves and, of course, found out that they share a name and started talking. They quickly realized that the technology used for SAGE, a real-time online and connected digital system, was exactly what the airline needed to manage its reservation system. So not a month passed before the two companies started working on a technological solution known as the Semi-Automated Business Research Environment, SABRE for short. So when you book a flight, even today, you are using the same SABRE system, and it should not surprise you that the next leap forward started with the military. In the late 1960s, the U.S. Department of Defense established the Advanced Research Project Agency Network. ARPANET departed from the central brain mainframe model to become the first wide area distributed and shared control a computer network. In the ARPANET model, every computer was a smart host that communicated directly with other hosts. And this lack of a central brain created a variety of communication channels and meant that there will be no single point of failure. So that was an especially useful trait for, of course, market that was intended to survive an enemy nuclear attack. Okay, so, this is a trivia fact, yeah. So the first internet felony was committed by Leonard Nero back in around 1973. So back then, personal use of ARPANET was strictly forbidden, but Leonard, a scofflaw, used ARPANET to request the return of the electric razor he accidentally forgot in England. So in the early 1980s, ARPANET was expanded for military use to service the National Science Foundation's computer science network and facilitated networking between research and academic departments. Okay, so before ARPANET, computer networks used dedicated point-to-point connection. This method is called circuit switching, and it resembled early telephone switchboards where a human was needed to physically plug in a cable in order to connect subscribers. The advantage to circuit switching is that users get to enjoy the full bandwidth and they are not interrupted by other devices. But there are downsides. If the connection is broken, communication is dropped. Expansion is constrained since all communications must be routed through a limited number of nodes. And it's extremely inefficient as all unused bandwidth goes, to waste. As an analogy, think of circuit switching as the equivalent of you and I buying a taxi and paving a dedicated road just to exchange goods. As you already know, our taxi would be idle on the days we don't use it and wasteful when delivering a small package. In the early 1960s, two scientists independently came up with similar ideas for improving network efficiency. So Paul Baran called his a distributed adaptive message block switching, while Donna Davis called it packet switching. The idea behind both is similar. So to take the original message, break it up into smaller standard size units called packets. All packets are addressed to the same destination, but being independently unit, each can travel by a different route, taking advantage of any available bandwidth. So when all packets arrive at their destination, they are reassembled back into the original message. Using our taxi analogy, remember, we could divide the goods that we want to exchange into standard size, flat rate boxes, the packets, and then deliver them independently of one another using existing carriers, such as SalPost or DHL. All right, so SalPost, using a taxi analogy, already owns, we are assuming, already owns intermediate nodes and shipping centers and taxis that travel between them. They can route a package independently for optimal use of all available bandwidth. And the same principle applies to packets switching. So splitting the message into packets allows networks to be flexible, resilient, and much more efficient. Organizations with multiple computers located in close proximity, such as in an office building or a home, that need unlimited use and full control over their network may choose to implement their own. So this type of network is called a local area network. By contrast, A wide area network is deployed over a large area. WANs, for short, wide area network, are used to connect cities, regions, countries, and continents. The most familiar example of a WAN or wide area network is your own internet service provider. Networks are comprised of multiple layers of organization and function stacked on each other. Most LANs use a technology called Ethernet, which encompasses two of these layers, a physical one and the logical one. So the physical layer consists of the network cables. So back to our taxi analogy, like networks, signpost needs multiple layers of resources too. The most obvious are the physical assets, like the taxis, the roads, and the drivers, but these are not enough. These physical assets can't function without a set of universal agreements and shared language protocols that govern driving rules, road signs, and zip codes. So these form a second layer that utilizes the physical resources of the layer below. And without it, chaos will reign and our packages won't be delivered. Okay, so similarly, Ethernet requires more than just the physical cable. It too needs a universal language agreement that enables reliable transmission of data between the physically connected nodes. So these are the equivalent of the traffic rules that enable trucks to share a road. So two layers make up Ethernet, but more are needed for the internet to work. The internet, quite distinct from Ethernet, you can Google that. So the internet has its own protocol, a name you have probably heard before. It's called IP. IP is a protocol stack that resides on top of the Ethernet. Okay, so IP stands for Internet Protocol and is responsible for addressing, routing, and controlling traffic over multiple network nodes. Okay, so IP addresses consist of four numbers between 0 and 255, each to uniquely identify each and every node on the network. So TCP stands for Transmission Control Protocol, and it makes up a transport layer that lives on top of IP and provides ordered error-free communication. So TCP can take a larger a packet that doesn't fit in a single IP message, segment it, send it over multiple routes, and reassemble it back at its destination. So, and it does all that while the underlying IP layer is completely oblivious to it. So think of TCP as a logistics department. So logistics may divide it to multiple smaller shipments. And much like IP, the taxi driver, back to our taxi analogy, may be completely oblivious to this fact, right? So, and yet IP is still not enough. There is one more layer that is needed to make the internet work. Sorry. Okay. So that's the application layer, the most important layer in the stack. Okay, it is what we interact with. You can think of it as the business aspect of our taxi delivery service, price negotiations, purchase orders, and payment. The taxis, routes, and drivers, and the traffic rules are there to facilitate it. One common application that most people recognize is called the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and you are using HTTP right now on this live class. HTTP is a distributed, a collaborative hypermedia information transfer protocol. HTTP acts as a translator between the end users and the network. So for example, when you type www.google.com in your browser, the Google homepage appears as if by magic, when in fact, under the covers, you just set in motion a vast chain of events that goes up and down and round every single network layer. Other applications use different protocols, but they all work in a similar fashion. The internet is a global system of interconnected computer networks. So physical and logical layers, devices and protocols enable it, but that still doesn't give us the World Wide Web. So the term internet and the World Wide Web are often used without much distinction. However, the two terms do not mean the same thing. The internet is a global system of interconnected computer networks, and in contrast, the World Wide Web is a global collection of documents and other resources which are linked by hyperlink. It's very important to know. You should note this. So web resources are accessed using HTTP, which are application level internet protocols that use the internet underlying transport protocols, or TCP/IP, to facilitate communications. Great. So I think it was William Gibson, a science fiction writer, used the term cyberspace in two short stories. Okay. He defined it as a consensual hallucination experienced daily by billions of legitimate operators in every nation. The term caught up, and cyberspace became synonymous with the internet and the World Wide Web. Cyberspace has become a space for free expression, art, finance, trade, activism, alternate realities, gaming, and social interaction. Yet, at the same time, hate crime and exploitation. So cyberspace is not bound by geographical boundaries or centralized control. So regulation is, let's say, challenging. So there is no single authority that governs neither the technical aspect nor the policies of the internet and the World Wide Web, but there are recognized groups made up of international and local entities that are involved in internet governance. So some are volunteer groups without a clear legal status, and one such group is the Internet Engineering Task Force. The IETF is responsible for regulating TCP/IP, and I think much more, but this is their major role. So the IETF is now a subsidiary of the Internet Society, a US nonprofit whose declared mission is to advance the development and application of the internet infrastructure, technologies, and open standards worldwide. Other entities include names such as the African and the Caribbean Internet Addresses Registry, the Internet Governance Forum, and a bunch of other acronyms. But the bottom line is that the internet governance is far from uniform. The scope and the authority and the jurisdiction of various bodies are poorly defined, and right now, the future regulation of cyberspace is uncertain at best. However, while it is difficult to regulate a non-corporeal entity, it is much easier to regulate people. So, who and what is protecting you and your interest in cyberspace? Internet security analysis divides threats into four categories. So there is malware, there is malicious attacks, there is phishing, and there is a denial of service. The most common threat is a malicious software or malware. So malware is any software that is used to disrupt normal operations, harvest private information, unauthorized access to a computer system. It includes viruses, spyware, ransomware, and worms. So next to that is malicious attackers who can exploit vulnerabilities in legitimate applications to obtain unauthorized access and disrupt activities. So notable victims include Adobe, eBay, LinkedIn, Yahoo, and of course, Equifax breach that exposed the personal data of over 150 million US consumers. I don't know if you have heard about the Equifax breach. If not, you can always Google that. So next to that is the phishing attack, which is designed to trick users into voluntarily providing sensitive information by pretending to be trustworthy source. So such as a corporate web page or maybe a legitimate email address, okay? So finally, to that is the denial of service. So it's typically target high-profile corporation to disrupt normal operations and service availability. So another form of cybercrime involves personal safety, activities like cyber stalking, cyber bullying, online predation have skyrocketed as more and more people share their lives online. So cyber crimes are by far the fastest growing crime sector in the world. So the financial damages caused by cyber crime are estimated to exceed about $6 trillion by 2020. And that's more than the entire globe trade of all illegal drugs combined. However, there are ways to reduce your risks of becoming a cybercrime victim. So network data encryption, internet protocol security, and advanced authentication methods like smart cards, fingerprints, and facial recognition, multi-factor authentication, and password managers can discourage unauthorized access to systems and data. Plus firewalls that monitor incoming traffic and identify suspicious sources, can help minimize exposure and block attempts of malicious intrusion. Of course, antivirus software that can scan for known threats can prevent or reduce the risk of infection. All the technical means and every countermeasure on the planet are not fully proof against the element of human error. And if there's one thing you can count on, it is human error. But there are a few common sense precautions that every organization and person must take to minimize the risks of becoming a cybercrime victim. Okay, so some of these are, of course, you should always use security software from a well-known vendor on all your devices. You should always use multi-factor authentication, right, for emails and every password-enabled site, device, and so on, software, okay? And importantly, you should only use websites that support encrypted SSL communications. We spoke about that in the last class, a secured HTTP, website and unsecured and all of that. Yeah. So you should, again, keep your passwords complex and diverse. Okay. And you should keep your devices and software up to date. It's very important, regularly keep your devices up to date. Regularly, your apps, regularly update them, because, they can fix bugs, and you should endeavor to read release notices, for such updates and see what the changes are. Very important. Avoid this. This has been, if not the scamming, the continuous scamming of the century, You should avoid the diseased billionaire Nigerian princes and all, other too good to be true offers, irregular Facebook friend we just chat you up, he's a prince in Nigeria, you should send some money and all of that. You should just avoid that. That's too good to be true. It's a too good to be true offer. Okay, so avoid clicking on links or opening email attachments if you have any slightest doubt about the origin of safety, right? Unless you are the, originator. Yeah. Never really reveal personal information online, okay? Again, unless you initiated the conversation, okay? And more importantly, you should always educate yourself, keep yourself informed, keep your peers informed and your family about cyber crimes. Okay, and yes, all these precautions listed here, it is true that no number of precautions will ever be human error proof. But these precautions will reduce your vulnerability to intrusion and attack and give you the peace of mind that you need to you know, come here and attend your live classes, enjoy your videos. And if you are into football, enjoy your fantasy football leagues. Yeah. So that brings us to the end of this lecture. And So when we decided to start the Alternate School Disruptive Program, I had no idea just how much I would learn from it. You know, looking at how the internet developed out of the early effort at long distance communication, I made it clear just how fundamentally it has changed our lives. And the accelerating speed of that change is just breathtaking. So with that, we come to the end of this lecture once more. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed making it. And please let us know your honest opinions on the Discord server, a discussion channel. So we read it frequently, and I promise to always reply your comment. Of course, your presence should be felt on Twitter. And I think I should share with you the documenting your journey a lecture. Yeah, that's a bonus lecture. So it will not be held live, but I will definitely share with you guys. And So always be, like I said, your honest opinion, just say, you know, and we always try to improve and, you know, find ways of appealing to you better. So thank you. At this juncture, should you have any question, you know, any, the floor is open for discussion virtually. So thank you very much. So any question from anyone here, you can unmute your mic and go on, or any comment, any contribution, just have your say. Okay, maybe a guy shying from the mic. Well, you can alternatively just comment, and we always reply. Or are guys asleep?
No, we are here.
Oh, okay, great. I thought you yeah, so anyone at all?
For me, there is not much question to see, because the documentation was well presented, so you know, we've learned a lot. We just hope to help the site as you promised.
Yeah, sure. We'll try to summarize the slides and make it available to you. But alternatively, is your notepad by you, because that's so important. You should be keeping notes, especially. It's mandatory. I should hasten to point this out. It's mandatory to, share your journey on Twitter, you know, for visibility. And of course, you never know who is watching. That's where everything is happening. That's so you should have your notepad after this class. Maybe at daybreak, you will hop on Twitter or even ASAP. And just document your journey, you know, have it kind of, I normally call it a digital portfolio. So that's where most often recruiters go, you know, some people want to be part of your journey. They want to see you grow. Any comment from anyone? Let's discuss.
Okay. Just how to what you just said, I'm really appreciate the videos put on stuff out there on Twitter. Like, I just did, like, and don't want to watch. Oh, your name was recommended to me years ago in a great community. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Ah, great. So I literally just met Ruben, and of course, like he noted, he was on Twitter, you know, putting up his needs and all, and he was referred to me, so by
by the giant. She's a giant in the tech community. You know, she's just amazing. You know, Ivy. So Ruben was referred here, and here he is. So you never know who is watching. So there's a whole lecture. I did a whole bonus lecture on that. I will share that when I upload it on the YouTube. The YouTube is private. Like I said, you should be present during the live classes. We are working maybe, you know, on ways to provide you, especially those who are present during the live classes. We are deliberating on whether to, you know, provide you the videos, just you, link to the video, so you know, you can always go back to it and see how you can, you know. But it's really mandatory, it's really important to attend the live classes, because, you know, these are the techie hours for me. I mean, these are my convenient hours for working. So yeah, any other comments? So Ruben, you're welcome into this great family and this great community. And yeah, we hope you enjoy your stay. Any other comment from anybody? Joel, are you still with us? Boakai, Umu, Ibrahim, Alfred. I'll be ending this meeting in 2 minutes. So.
Okay, what I want to add again is with the Discord, this link you shared to me, I'll link it with Bryce. I will post that so you can erase it.
Sure. I will do that just after this meeting. I will try to create a forever link. Anyway, so yeah, Umu, hi. Can you be a bit audible? Thank you. Oh, great. Thank you for being here too. She's a lady, very elegant, you know, being up at such an normal people order, because this is not a developer's order. Yeah, this is just a normal hour for you know, a regular developer. So thank you for the consistency and the, you know, for being here, Umu. I'll keep it up. So guys, any words from you? This meeting will be ending in literally 60 seconds. Okay, so guys, please, for Ruben, who is just joining us, please refer him, resend the important messages, especially the class time, the class schedule, all other relevant messages, please resend for him, so you know he can always reference those.
Thank you, I really appreciate it.
Oh, great. Otherwise, that brings us to the end of this lecture. Thank you. I hope you find this lecture useful, and I'll see you on the next class as per our class schedule. Thank you very much, and bye.